In the next 15 minutes, we'll just see how we treat severe neonatal jaundice, and this is the crash cart approach. We all know that neonatal hyperbilirubinemia or jaundice is a very common problem in NICU, and hence we need to have a very systematic assessment to find out which are the babies which are likely to go into severe jaundice and encephalopathy. How does one stabilize these babies? Which investigations to send whenever we see a jaundiced baby with involving the palms and soles, which has come to you, and what are the management principles in terms of physiotherapy exchange or medical management? These are my objectives of today's presentation. When we look at steps for crash cart approach, basically what my intention is, how does one assess the risk of severe jaundice and babies going to bilirubin encephalopathy? Which are the laboratory tests? And mind well, one does not wait for the reports to come. What are the immediate interventions and what are the definitive therapies? When we look at assessment of severity of jaundice in a newborn baby, if I look at a baby with a gestational age more than 35 weeks, we know there is cephalopodal progression of jaundice. So whenever we have jaundice which is involving the palms and soles, can I be very confident that this is a baby who has got severe jaundice? We know limitations of visual assessment. What is the age of presentation? A bilirubin of 15 on day 1 versus a bilirubin of 15 on day 5 has a different bearing altogether in our approach and management of jaundice. Which are the babies who have got evidence of encephalopathy with hyperbilirubinemia? A baby with refusal to feed, retropolis officinalis, we have already missed the bus. And can we assess for certain risk factors in terms of hyperbilirubinemia in the previous pregnancy or this pregnancy, which puts this baby at higher risk of developing severe jaundice and encephalopathy? We have a very good way of screening jaundice with transcutaneous bilirubinometry, but it has its own limitations. So what is left with us is a serum bilirubin estimation by biochemical method. We all know handicaps of visual assessment, and one can never be confident in a baby because skin pigmentation is varying between a fair baby and a dark baby. A baby who is polycythemic and plethoric, appreciation of jaundice may be difficult. A baby with natural light versus artificial light, again appreciation is going to be difficult. A baby who has received prior sunlight phototherapy, again a bilirubin estimation just by visual inspection will not give us a good clue. Hence, one needs to send a serum bilirubin whenever you see a baby with jaundice or severe jaundice. What are the risk factors that puts a baby at risk of severe hyperbilirubinemia or severe jaundice? Whenever you see a jaundice in first 24 hours, unless put otherwise, is a medical emergency, look for hemolysis, ABO or RH incompatibility or minor blood group incompatibilities. Pre-discharge serum bilirubin in high-risk zone, and here we are talking of our specific bilirubin. So from today, we all should be looking in the first week of life, any baby with jaundice, don't look at day of life. Because a day 2 baby may be 25 hours old or it may still be 47 hours old. Hence, we should be talking as our specific bilirubin, and this is the norm. Look for cephalhematoma or bruising, significant weight loss in the first week of life, by which if there is more than 2% per day or more than 10% weight loss in the first week of life, again puts that baby at higher risk of severe jaundice. Late preterm, that's 35 to 36 weeks, which are ignored by neonatologists as well as obstetricians. And previous baby with unexplained hyperbilirubinemia, these are risk factors for severe jaundice in this pregnancy. Can we predict which newborn baby is going to develop severe jaundice? Look at our specific bilirubin norms, and these are available by the American Academy of Pediatrics, and look for presence or absence of risk factors. And this is how we would look at our specific bilirubin norms, look at the hour of life, and look at risk factor, whether it is a low, intermediate or high risk factor, and if depending on these levels of bilirubin at that age in the postnatal life, one can decide whether we need to give intensive phototherapy, whether we need to give phototherapy at all, or whether we need to exchange transfusion. We all know bilirubin is a natural antioxidant in lower doses, but if it is higher, it is going to cross the blood-brain barrier and it is going to cause bilirubin-induced neurological dysfunction or bilirubin encephalopathy. Higher the level of bilirubin, higher are the chances of bilirubin encephalopathy, but one cannot say as to which baby is going to develop bilirubin encephalopathy, and this obviously is going to depend on the age of presentation and prematurity. Smaller the baby, higher are the chances of encephalopathy. Hemolytic jaundice, especially G6PD, birth asphyxia, infections where the blood-brain barrier is altered, metabolic acidosis, temperature instability, and albumin less than 3 grams. All these are going to increase the chances of bilirubin encephalopathy in a baby with severe jaundice, because bilirubin is going to traverse and get transferred across the blood-brain barrier to get deposited in the brain and cause injury. Are there any risk scores where one can look at these risk factors and risk scores and predict which severe jaundice is going to develop bilirubin encephalopathy? And if you know birth weight, oxytocin using pregnancy, vacuum, breastfeeding or water feeding, exclusive breastfeeding, and gestational age less than 38 weeks. A score of 8 or more predicts or can give us a clue, as these are the factors which puts the baby at higher risk of developing severe neonatal jaundice. What is BIND, bilirubin-induced neurological dysfunction? Look at three parameters: mental status, muscle tone, and cry. And this is a score which is available. If you have a baby with altered mental status, you can give 1, 2, and 3 points. A comatose baby gets 3 points. A baby with severe hypertonia or opisthotonus gets 3 points. And a baby with inconsolable cry, which is not getting controlled by stimulation, is going to get 3 points. Whenever you have 4 to 6, it's 1B, and if the score is 7 to 9, it's a severe advanced bilirubin encephalopathy. And you can see in this picture, obviously there is opisthotonus or retropolis and opisthotonic posturing. The baby has seizures and the baby has cry, which is inconsolable. Obviously the score here is more than 8. The risk of bilirubin encephalopathy and sequelae are higher in this baby. So we have missed the bus, and this is the baby who is going to develop sequelae. So when we look at crash cart approach, the basic principles of management in this, when a baby with jaundice comes to an emergency in the NICU, look at the thermal stability, give intravenous fluids if the baby is dehydrated, most important, cross-match and organize for blood transfusion, for exchange transfusion, start intensive phototherapy. Please do not wait for the reports to come, because every minute is important, and we will see how we would use intensive phototherapy. Repeat a bilirubin in the next 2 to 4 hours, and the serum bilirubin is still high or increasing, obviously this is a candidate for exchange transfusion. Severe jaundice with neurological injury, there is no point in waiting, one needs to do an urgent exchange transfusion. Severe jaundice without encephalopathy, we need to look at interventions and therapies which are going to help reduce the bilirubin and thereby minimize the bilirubin encephalopathy. So how does one clinically assess jaundice? We know we have seen head-to-toe examination, look for kephals, bruising, look for kephalopodal progression of jaundice. Weight deficit. If there is increased weight loss by more than 10%, obviously there is dehydration, there is hyperviscosity, there is relative dehydration to polycythemia, which is going to cause hyperbilirubinemia. And the baby with dehydration, no matter how good you give phototherapy, will never be able to show a decline in bilirubin levels. So assess hydration, assess feeding adequacy, and look for signs of bilirubin encephalopathy. What are the laboratory tests that one needs to do when a baby with severe jaundice comes to you in pediatric emergency or neonatal emergency? Please do a total serum bilirubin, both conjugated and unconjugated fraction. Look at the direct Coombs test for immune-mediated hemolysis, as in RH, reticulocyte count for hemolytic anemia, and a peripheral blood smear for evidence of hemolysis. We need to have mother and baby's blood group. G6PD, especially in North India, which is very common, but mind well, G6PD can come negative in acute hemolysis. If there is a very strong suspicion, there needs to repeat a G6PD at 3 months and look at serum albumin and electrolytes. Why albumin? Because 1 gram of albumin binds with 8 milligrams of bilirubin. So anything which is more than 3 is reassuring. When you look at interventions, we need to look at bilirubin reducing measures. Intravenous fluids are one of the basic modalities, especially in a baby with dehydration, intensive phototherapy, and exchange. Let us look at phototherapy. How does one make phototherapy become more efficacious or effective to reduce severe jaundice? What are things one would monitor, and when does one stop phototherapy? Starting phototherapy, very easy. Look at our specific bilirubin norms, and these have been published by the American Academy of Pediatrics. So look at the hour, look at the risk factors, and one can start phototherapy. Weight and gestation are good guidelines. If you have a baby with prematurity, obviously one needs to follow guidelines for premature baby. Look at age in life, age of life in hours and not days. and look for risk factors, as we have already discussed about bilirubin-induced neurological dysfunction. These are the AAP nomograms, which are our specific bilirubin norms for phototherapy, and these are available freely online. So one can look at bilirubin level at 72 hours or 48 hours, depending on the risk factors, start phototherapy. How does one make phototherapy more effective? We need to have appropriate intensity of light, which is nothing but we need to have the wavelength between 460 to 490 nanometers. We need to have phototherapy which is more efficacious in terms of irradiance or intensity. And irradiance is nothing but you are bringing the phototherapy closer to the baby, makes us give more irradiance. Minimize the clothing and make the body surface area more available so that the spectral power or area exposed increases, and look at the baby characteristics in form of hydration, feeding and temperature. This is the LED phototherapy, where the baby phototherapy is as close to the baby as possible, and you are minimizing the size of the diaper covering the eyes, making phototherapy becoming more efficacious. Irradiance of the phototherapy is increased if you bring the phototherapy as close to the baby as possible, except halogen phototherapy, which is likely to cause burns, or sometimes fluorescent phototherapies can cause overheating, hence we make a distance of about 40 cm. But overall, LED phototherapies are the ones which are currently being used, and by giving intensive phototherapy, we mean that the flux here is something like 30 nanometers per micro watt per centimeter, and this phototherapy should be as close to the baby as possible. Reflecting lights or aluminium foils or white cloth, where phototherapy rays are reflected back to the baby, so that these are adjuvant ways by which your phototherapy efficacy can be increased, but this should not be at the cost of monitoring the baby when the baby is under phototherapy. So we need to monitor the baby with severe jaundice and not cover the baby. What are the care that one needs to take during phototherapy? Repeat a bilirubin after 2 to 4 hours if you have a baby with severe jaundice, continue hydration, give tube feeding, and ensure that baby gets continuous, uninterrupted, intensive phototherapy to get the maximum benefits. When does one stop phototherapy and what are things one would monitor? When a baby is under phototherapy, transcutaneous bilirubinometry has very minimal role, and hence we need to look at serum bilirubin levels. Repeat a bilirubin within the next 2 to 4 hours and show that the decrement is at least 2 mg per deciliter. There is a chance that the bilirubin can increase after stopping phototherapy, then that's a rebound rise of bilirubin. When does one do exchange? Look at the total serum bilirubin levels and follow the AP charts or nomograms as to if the intensive phototherapy fails to show a decrement by more than 0.5 mg per deciliter per hour or more than 2 mg in 4 hours. Or anytime you have a baby with total serum bilirubin more than the age specific nomograms, or you have earliest sign of bilirubin induced neurological dysfunction, one would do exchange. The way one would do exchange is, in the case of Rh negative, if there is hydrox or cord bilirubin more than 5, or AP nomograms more than 35 weeks, where thresholds are mentioned, where you can look at these nomograms and decide about doing an exchange transfusion. The way one would do exchange is a double volume exchange transfusion by using push and pull technique. Do it as early as possible without waiting, but ensure that the baby is maintained in hemodynamic stability. These are scenarios wherein if the mother is O, the donor blood group should be O. If the mother is negative, the donor blood group should be negative. And in other situations, is O and A, one would use O negative, B negative, A positive baby, one would use A negative, cross-match with the mother, and if the mother is AB negative and baby is B positive, one would use B negative. Needless to emphasize that there is definitely a role of hydration in a baby with intensive phototherapy, especially if the sodium is more than 150 or there is 10% weight loss, one would start IV fluids and monitor serum electrolytes. Very minimal role for pharmacological agents in management of neonatal jaundice. Albumin, which was used once upon a time, 1 gram per kilo before exchange, doesn't seem to have any role in babies with severe jaundice unless the albumin is very low. IVIG has questionable role in management of babies with hemolytic jaundice, especially Rh incompatibility. In the first 6 hours of life, one could try giving 0.5 to 1 gram, again has a debatable role in managing babies with Rh incompatibility. Phenobarbital, we all know, is an enzyme inducer for UDP glucuronate transferase. which was once used in the 1980s and 90s, has no role because it induces sedation and has slower onset of action. T-mesoporphyrin, which is a heme oxygen inhibitor, was tried in babies with hyperbilirubinemia, again has no role and has not been approved for use. So, where do we go in managing a baby with severe jaundice? We all know severe jaundice is a medical emergency. It has a potential to develop bilirubin encephalopathy, and we know the risk factors that can potentially a baby develop bilirubin encephalopathy and its sequelae. In such scenarios, please start intensive phototherapy as early as possible. Assess and send laboratories, but don't wait for the investigations to come for starting phototherapy. Whenever you have neurological involvement, the first thing to do would be an early exchange. So we need to arrange for blood transfusion as soon as the baby comes with severe jaundice. Start hydration, because this is something which will help reduce the bilirubin levels faster. Prepare for exchange transfusion. And what is important here is aggressive supportive care, and by which we mean hydration, thermal stability, and monitoring the baby with severe jaundice to prevent bilirubin encephalopathy and its sequelae. Thank you.